This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, A Virginia Cavalier. Author, Molly Elliot Seawell. Chapter 1. Nature made Washington great, but he made himself virtuous. The sun shines not upon a lovelier land than Midland, Virginia. Great rivers roll seaward through rich woodlands and laughing cornfields and fair meadowlands. Afar off, the misty lines of blue hills shine faintly against the deeper blue of the sky. The atmosphere is singularly clear, and the air wholesome and refreshing. Never was it more beautiful than on an afternoon in late October of 1746. The Indian summer was at hand, that golden time when nature utters a solemn hush to the season and calls back the summertime for a little while. The scene was full of peace, the broad and placid Rappahannock shimmering in the sun, its bosom unvexed except by the sails of an occasional grain-laden vessel making its way quietly and slowly down the Blue River. The quiet homesteads lay basking in the fervid sun, while woods and streams and fields were full of those soft, harmonious country sounds which make a kind of musical silence. A mile or two back from the river ran the King's Highway, a good road for those days and showing signs of much travel. It passed at one point through a natural clearing, on the top of which grew a few melancholy pines. The road came out of the dense woods on one side of this open space, and disappeared in the woods on the other side. On this October afternoon, about 3 o'clock, a boy with a gun on his shoulder and a dog at his heels came noiselessly out of the woods and walked up to the top of the knoll. The day was peculiarly still, but only the quickest ear could have detected the faint sound the boy made, as with a quick and graceful step he marched up the hill. For George Washington was a natural woodsman from his young boyhood, and he had early learned how to make his way through forest and field without so much as alarming the partridge on her nest. No art or craft of the woods, whether of white man or Indian, was unknown to him, and he understood nature, the mighty mother, in all her civilized and uncivilized moods. A full game bag on his back showed what his employment had been, but now he gave himself over to the rare but delicious idleness which occasionally overtakes everybody who tramps long through the woods. He sat down and took off his cap, revealing his handsome blonde head. The dog, a beautiful long-eared setter, laid his nose confidentially upon his master's knee and blinked solemnly with his large tawny eyes into his master's blue ones. The boy's eyes were remarkable, a light but beautiful blue, and softening a face that even in boyhood was full of resolution and even sternness. His figure was as near perfection as the human form could be, tall, athletic, clean of limb and deep of chest, singularly graceful and developed, as the wise old Greeks developed their bodies by manly exercises and healthful brain work and the cleanest and most wholesome living. Neither the face nor the figure could belong to a milksop. The indications of strong passions, of fierce loves and hates and resentments, were plain enough. But stronger even than these was that noble expression, which a purity of soul and a commanding will always writes upon the human countenance. This boy was a gentleman at heart and in soul, not because he had no temptation to be otherwise, but because he chose to be a gentleman. He sat in silence for half an hour, the dog resting against him, the two communing together as only a boy and a dog can. The sun shone, the wind scarcely ruffled a dying leaf. A crow circled around in the blue air, uttering a caw that was lost in the immensity of the heavens. The silence seemed to grow deeper every moment, when, with a quick movement, George laid his ear to the ground. To an unpracticed ear there was not the slightest break in the quiet, but to the boy's trained hearing something was approaching along the highway, which induced him to sit still a while longer. It was some time in coming, for the heavy coaches in those days hung upon wide leather straps, and with broad tired wheels made much commotion as they rolled along, to say nothing of the steady beat of the horses' hoofs upon the hard road. George's eyes were as quick as his ears, but he caught nothing of the approaching travelers, until the cavalcade flashed suddenly into the sun, and with its roar and rattle seemed to spring out of the ground. First came four sturdy Negro outriders, in a gorgeous livery of green and gold, and mounted upon stout bay horses well adapted for hard travel. Then came a magnificent traveling coach, crest emblazoned, which would not have discredited the king's levy. It was drawn by four superb roans, exactly matched in form, color, and action. They took the road as if they had just warmed up to their work, but from the dust on the whole cavalcade it was plain they had traveled far that day. With heads well in the air, the horses threw their legs together with a style and at a gait that showed them to be of the best blood in the horse kingdom. A black postillion in green and gold rode the off-horse of the leaders, while a black coachman handled the reins. On the box next the coachman sat a white man, evidently a servant out of livery. One glance told that he was an old soldier. He had at his side one of the huge holsters of the day, in which he carried a pair of long horse pistols, and a stout wooden box, upon which he rested his feet, showed that the party had means of defense had it been attacked. George was so stunned with admiration at the splendor of the equipage that he scarcely glanced at the interior of the coach until the sunlight flashed upon something that fairly dazzled him. It was a diamond-hilted dress sword, worn by a gentleman of about 50, who sat alone upon the back seat. The gorgeous sword hilt was the only thing about him that shone or glinted, for his brown traveling suit was as studiously simple as his equipage was splendid. He wore plain silver buckles at his knees and upon his handsome high-arched feet, and his hair, streaked with gray, was without powder and tied into a club with a black ribbon. One glance at his face fixed George's attention. It was pale and somewhat angular, unlike the type of florid, high-colored Virginia squires with which George was familiar. He had been handsome in his youth, and was still handsome with a stately, grave beauty, but even a boy could see that this man had had but little joy in life. From the moment that George's eyes fell upon this gentleman, he looked upon nothing else. Neither the great coach nor the superb horses had any power to attract his gaze, although never, in all his short life, had he seen anything so splendid. His mother had a coach, and so had most of the people round about, but all had a common air of having once been handsome, and of having reached the comfortable, shabby, genteel stage. And many persons drove four horses to these great lumbering vehicles, but all four would not be worth one of the gallant roans that trotted along the road so gaily. It was out of sight in a few minutes, and in a few minutes more it was out of hearing. But in that time George, who was quick-witted, had shrewdly guessed the name and rank of the gentleman with the plain clothes and the diamond-hilted sword. It was the great Earl of Fairfax, the soldier, the wit, the rich nobleman, who for some mysterious reason had chosen to come to this new land and to build a lodge in the wilderness. The boy had often heard his mother, Madam Washington, speak of Earl Fairfax. Meeting with him was one of the events of that great journey she had made in her girlhood to England, where for a time she lived in the house of her brother Joseph Ball, at Cookham in Berkshire, who had left his Virginia home and had taken up his residence in England. Here Mary Ball had met Augustine Washington, then in England upon affairs connected with his property. Augustine Washington was one of the handsomest men of his day, and from him his eldest son George inherited the noble air and figure that marked him. Mary Ball was a Virginia beauty, and although admired by many Englishmen of distinction, she rather chose to marry Augustine Washington, albeit he had been married before and had two motherless boys. In England, therefore, were they married, sailing soon after for Virginia, and within 12 years Mrs. Washington was a widow with 5 children. She loved to talk to her children of those happy English days, when she had first pledged herself to Augustine Washington. It had also been the only time of excitement in her quiet life, and she had met many of the wits and cavaliers and belles of the reign of George II. She sometimes spoke of Lord Fairfax, but always guardedly, and George had conceived the idea that his mother perhaps knew Lord Fairfax better, and the reasons for his abandonment of his own country, than she cared to tell. He began to wonder, quite naturally, where the Earl was bound, and suddenly it came to him in a flash, "He is going to pay his respects to my mother." In another instant, he was on his feet and speeding like a deer through the woods towards home. The house at Ferry Farm, which was home to him, was a good 4 miles by the road, but by paths through the woods and fields and a footbridge across a creek it was barely a mile. It took him but a short time to make it, but before he could reach the house he saw the coach and outriders dash into sight and draw up before the porch. The old soldier jumped from the box and opened the door and let down the steps, and the earl descended in state. On the porch stood Uncle Jasper, the venerable black butler, in a suit of homespun, with a long white apron that reached from his chin to his knees. George saw him bowing and ushering the earl in. The outriders loosened their horses' girths, and after breathing them, led them to the watering trough in the stable lot back of the house. They then watered the coach horses, the coachman sitting in solitary magnificence on his box, while the old soldier stretched his legs by walking about the lot. George saw this as he came through the stable way, his dog still at his heels. Uncle Jasper was waiting for him on the back porch. "To madam," he began in a mysterious whisper, "will want you ter put on yo Sunday clothes fo you come in ter see de Earl o' Fairfax. He's in de settin' room now." George understood very well, and immediately went to his room to change his hunting clothes, which were the worse for both dirt and wear. It was a ceremonious age, and the formalities of dress and manners were very strictly observed. Meanwhile, in the sitting room on opposite sides of the fireplace, sat Madam Washington and the Earl. Truly, the beauty that had distinguished Mary Ball remained with Madam Washington. Her figure was slight and delicate. Not from her had her eldest son inherited his brawn and muscle, and in her severely simple black gown she looked even slighter than usual. Her complexion was dazzlingly fair, and little rings of chestnut hair escaped from her widow's cap, but her fine blue eyes were the counterpart of her eldest son's. The room was plainly furnished, even for the times, but scrupulously neat. A rag carpet covered the middle of the floor, while around the edges the polished planks were bare. In one corner a small harpsichord was open, with music on the rack. Dimity curtains shaded the small paned windows, and a great fire sparkled in the large fireplace. Over the mantel hung the portrait of a handsome young man in a satin coat with lace ruffles. This was a portrait of Augustine Washington in his youth. Opposite it was a portrait of Madam Washington as a girl, a lovely young face and figure. There were one or two other portraits, and a few pieces of silver upon a mahogany buffet opposite the harpsichord, relics of Wakefield, the Westmoreland plantation where George was born, and of which the house had burned to the ground in the absence of the master, and much of the household belongings had been destroyed. The Earl's eyes lingered upon the girlish portrait of Madam Washington, as the two sat gravely conversing. "It was thus you looked, madam, when I first had the honor of knowing you in England," he said. "Time and sorrow and responsibilities have done their work upon me, my lord," answered Madam Washington. "The care of 5 children, that they may be brought up to be worthy of their dead father, the making of good men out of 4 boys, the task of bringing up an only daughter to be a Christian gentlewoman, is no mean task, I assure you, and taxes my humble powers." "True, madam," responded the Earl with a low bow, "but I know of no woman better fitted for so great an undertaking than Madam Washington." Madam Washington leaned forward and bowed in response, and then resumed her upright position, not once touching the back of her chair. "And may I not have the pleasure of seeing your children, madam?" asked the Earl, who cared little for children generally, but to whom the children of her who had once been the beautiful Mary Ball were of the greatest interest. "Certainly, my lord," answered Madam Washington, rising, "if you will excuse me for a moment while I fetch them." The Earl, left alone, rose and walked thoughtfully to the portrait of Mary Ball, and looked at it for several minutes. His face, full of melancholy and weariness, grew more melancholy and weary. He shook his head once or twice, and made a motion with his hand as if putting something away from him, and then returned to his chair by the fire. He looked into the blaze, and tapped his foot softly with his dress sword. This beautiful grave widow of 40, her heart wrapped up in her children, was not the girl of 18 years before. There was no turning back of the leaves of the book of life for her. She had room now for but one thought in her mind, one feeling in her heart, her children. Presently, the door opened, and Madam Washington re-entered with her usual sedate grace. Following her was a young girl of 14, her mother's image, the quaintest, daintiest little maiden imaginable, her round white arms bare to the elbow, from which muslin ruffles fell back, a little muslin cap covering her hair, much lighter than her mother's, and her shy eyes fixed upon the floor. Behind her were three sturdy, handsome boys of 12, 10, and 8, as alike as peas in a pod. In those days, the children of gentle people were neither pert and forward, nor awkward and ashamed at meeting strangers. Drilled in a precise etiquette, they knew exactly what to do, which consisted chiefly in making many low bows to their elders, and answering in respectful monosyllables such questions as were asked them. They learned in this way a grace and courtesy quite unknown to modern children. My daughter, Mistress Betty Washington, my Lord of Fairfax, was Madam Washington's introduction. The Earl rose from his chair and made the little girl a bow as if she were the Princess Royal, while Mistress Betty, scorning to be outdone, curtsied to the floor in response, her full skirt making a balloon as she sunk and rose in the most approved fashion. "I am most happy to meet you, Mistress Betty," said he, to which Mistress Betty, in a quavering voice, for she had never before seen an earl or a coach like the one he came in, made answer, "Thank you, my lord." The three boys were then introduced as Samuel, John, and Charles. To each the earl made a polite bow, but not so low as to Mistress Betty. The boys returned the bow without the slightest shyness or awkwardness, and then took their places in silence behind their mother's chair. They exchanged keen glances, though, among themselves, and wondered when they would be allowed to depart, so that they might further investigate the coach and the four roan horses. Madam Washington spoke. "I am every moment expecting my eldest son, George. He is out hunting today, and said that he would return at this hour, and he is always punctual to the minute. It will be a severe disappointment to me if I should not have the pleasure of showing your lordship my eldest son." It did not take a very acute person to note the tone of pride in Madam's voice when she said, "My eldest son." "It will be a disappointment to me also, Madam," replied the Earl. "I hope he is all that the eldest son of such a mother should be." Madam Washington smiled one of her rare smiles. "'Tis all I can do, my lord, to keep down the spirit of pride, so unbecoming to all of us when I regard my son George. My other sons, I trust, will be as great a comfort to me, but they are still of too tender years for me to depend upon." Then, turning to the three boys, she gave them a look which meant permission to leave the room. The boys bowed gravely to their mother, gravely to the earl, and walked more gravely out of the room. Once the door was softly closed, they made a quick but noiseless dash for the back door, and were soon outside examining the roans and the great coach, chattering like magpies to the negro outriders, until having made the acquaintance of the old soldier, Lance by name, they were soon hanging about him, begging that he would tell them about a battle. Meanwhile, within the sitting room, Madam Washington heard a step upon the uncarpeted stairs. A light came into her eyes as she spoke. "There's my son now, going to his room. He will join us shortly. I cannot tell you, my lord, how great a help I have in my son. As you know, my stepson, Captain Lawrence Washington, late of the British Army, since leaving His Majesty's service and marrying Mistress Anne Fairfax, has lived at the Hunting Creek place, which he has called Mount Vernon, in honor of his old friend and comrade in arms, Admiral Vernon. It is a good day's journey from here, and although Lawrence is most kind and attentive, I have had to depend, since his marriage, upon my son George to take his father's place in the conduct of my affairs and in my household. It is he who reads family prayers night and morning, and presides with dignity at the foot of my table. It might seem strange to those who do not know his character how much I rely upon his judgment, and he but 15. Even my younger sons obey and respect him, and my daughter Betty does hang upon her brother. 'Tis most sweet to see them together." At which Mistress Betty smiled and glanced at the Earl, and saw so kind a look in his eyes as he smiled back at her that she looked at him quite boldly after that. "It is most gratifying to hear of this, madam," replied the Earl, "but it is hardly merciful of you to a childless old man, who would give many worldly advantages had he but a son to lean upon in his old age." "You should have married 20 years ago, my lord," answered Madam Washington promptly. Something like a gleam of saturnine humor appeared in the Earl's eyes at this, but he only replied dryly, Perhaps it is not wholly my fault, madam, that I find myself alone in my old age. At that moment the door opened, and young Washington stood upon the threshold. Chapter 2. The full flood of the sun, now low in the heavens, poured through the western windows upon the figure of the boy standing in the doorway. The room was beginning to darken, and the ruddy firelight, too, fell glowingly upon him. The Earl was instantly roused, and could scarcely persuade himself that the boy before him was only 15. 17 or even 18 would have seemed nearer the mark, so tall and well-developed was he. Like all creatures of the highest breeding, George looked handsomer the handsomer his dress. And although his costume was really simple enough, he had the splendid air that made him always appear to be in the highest fashion. His coat and knee breeches were of dark blue cloth, spun, woven, and dyed at home. His waistcoat, however, was of white brocade, and was made of his mother's wedding gown, Madam Washington having indulged her pride so far as to lay this treasured garment aside for waistcoats for her sons, while Mistress Betty was to inherit the lace veil and the string of pearls which had gone with the gown. George's shoe buckles and knee buckles were much finer than the Earl's, being of paste and having been once worn by his father. His blonde hair was made into a club, and tied with a black ribbon, while under his arm he carried a smart three-cornered hat, for the hat made a great figure in the ceremonious bows of the period. His dog, a beautiful creature, stood beside him. Never in all his life had the Earl of Fairfax seen so noble a boy. The sight of him smote the older man's heart. It flashed through him how easy it would be to exchange all his honors and titles for such a son. He rose and saluted him, as Madam Washington said, in a tone that had pride in every accent. "My lord, this is my son, Mr. Washington." George responded with one of those graceful inclinations which, years after, made the entrance of Colonel Washington at the Earl of Dunmore's levee at Williamsburg a lesson in grace and good breeding. Being Mr. Washington, and the head of the house, it became his duty to speak first. "This is my son, Mr. Washington. I am most happy to welcome you, my lord, to our home." "And I am most happy," said the Earl, "to meet once more my old friend, Madam Washington, and the goodly sons and sweet daughter with which she has been blessed. My mother has often told us of you, sir, in speaking of her life during the years she spent in England." "Ah, my lord," said Madam Washington, "I perceive I am no longer young, for I love to dwell upon those times, and to tell my children of the great men I met in England chiefly through your lordship's kindness." "It was my good fortune," said the Earl, "to be an humble member of the Spectator Club, and through the everlasting goodness of Mr. Joseph Addison, I had the advantage of knowing men so great of soul and so luminous of mind that I think I can never forget them. I had not the honor of knowing Mr. Addison. He died before I ever saw England," replied Madam Washington. "Unfortunately, yes, madam. But of those you knew, Mr. Pope, poor Captain Steele, and even Dean Swift, with all his ferocious wit, his tremendous invective, his savage thirst for place and power, respected Mr. Addison. He was a man of great dignity, not odd and misshapen like little Mr. Pope, nor frowsy like poor Dick Steele, nor rude and overbearing like the fierce Dean, but ever gentle, mild, and of a most manly bearing. For all Mr. Addison's mildness, I think there was no man that Dean Swift feared so much. When we would all meet at the club, and the Dean would begin his railing at persons of quality, for he always chose that subject when I was present, Mr. Addison would listen with a smile to the Dean as he lolled over the table in his huge periwig, and roared out in his great rich voice all the sins of all the people, always beginning and ending with Sir Robert Walpole, whom he hated most malignantly. Once, a pause coming in the Dean's talk, Mr. Addison, calmly taking out his snuffbox and helping himself to a pinch, remarked that he had always thought Dean Swift's chiefest weakness, until he had been assured to the contrary, was his love for people of quality. We each held our breath. Dick Steele quietly removed a pewter mug from the Dean's elbow. Mr. Pope, who sat next Mr. Addison, turned pale and slipped out of his chair. The Dean turned red and breathed hard, glaring at Mr. Addison, who only smiled a little, and then he, the great Dean Swift, the man who could make governments tremble and parliaments afraid, who made duchesses weep from his rude sneers and great ladies almost go down on their knees to him, sneaked out of the room at this little thrust from Mr. Addison. For 'twas the man, madam, the honest soul of him, that could cow that great swashbuckler of a genius. Mr. Addison abused no one, and he was exactly what he appeared to be. That indeed is the highest praise, as it shows the highest wisdom, answered Madam Washington. George listened with all his mind to this. He had read The Spectator, and Mr. Addison's tragedy of Cato had been read to him by Mr. Hobby, the Scotch schoolmaster who taught him, and he loved to hear of these great men. The Earl, although deep in talk with Madam Washington, was by no means unmindful of the boy, but without seeming to notice him, watched every expression of his earnest face. I once saw Dean Swift, continued Madam Washington. It was at a London rout, where I went with my brother's wife, Madam Joseph Ball, when we were visiting in London. He had great dark eyes, and sat in a huge chair, and called ladies of quality, my dear, as if they were dairymaids. And the ladies seemed half to like it, and half to hate it. They told me that two ladies had died of broken hearts, for him. I believe it to be true, replied the Earl. That was the last time the Dean ever saw England. He went to Ireland and, as he said, commenced Irishman in earnest and died very miserably. He could not be bought for money, but he could very easily be bribed with power. And that poor Captain Steele? The Earl's grave face was suddenly illuminated with a smile. Dear Dick Steele, the softest-hearted, bravest, gentlest fellow, always drunk and always repenting. There never was so great a sermon preached on drunkenness as Dick Steele himself was. But for drink he would have been one of the happiest, as he was by nature one of the best and truest gentlemen in the world, but he was weak, and he was, in consequence, forever miserable. Drink brought him to debts and duns and prison and rags and infamy. Ah, madam, 'twould have made your heart bleed as it made mine, to see poor Dick reeling along the street, dirty, unkempt, his sword bent, and he scarce knowing what he was doing, and next day at home where his wife and children were in hunger and cold and poverty, behold him lying in agony on his wretched bed, weeping, groaning, reproaching himself, and suffering tortures for 1 hour's wicked indulgence. Then would he turn gentleman again, and for a long time be our own dear Dick Steele, his wife smiling, his children happy. I love to think on honest Dick at these times. It was then he wrote that beautiful little book, which should be in every soldier's hands, The Christian Hero. We could always tell at the club whether Dick Steele were drunk or sober by Mr. Addison's face. When Steele was acting the beast, Mr. Addison sighed often and looked melancholy all the time and spent his money in taking such care as he could of the poor wife and children. Poor Dick! The end came at last in drunkenness and beastliness, but before he died for a little while, he was the Dick Steele we loved and shall ever love. And Mr. Pope, the queer little gentleman who lived at Twickenham and was so kind to his old mother? Mr. Pope was a very great genius, madam, and had he not been born crooked, he would have been an admirable man, but the crook in his body seemed to make a crook in his mind. He died but last year, outliving many strong men who pitied his puny frame. But let me not disparage Mr. Pope. My Lord Chesterfield, who was a very good judge of men, as well as the first gentleman of his time, entertained a high esteem for Mr. Pope. I also had the honor of meeting the Earl of Chesterfield, continued Madam Washington with animation, and he well sustained the reputation for politeness that I had heard of him, for he made as much of me as if I had been a great lady, instead of a young girl from the colonies, whom chance and the kindness of a brother had brought to England, and your lordship's goodness had introduced to many people of note. 'Tis true I saw them but for a glimpse or two, but that was enough to make me remember them forever. I have tried to teach my son Lord Chesterfield's manner of saluting ladies, in which he not only implied the deepest respect for the individual, but the greatest reverence for all women. That is true of my Lord Chesterfield, replied the Earl, who found it enchanting to recall these friends of his youth with whom he had lived in close intimacy, and his manners revealed the man. He had also a monstrous pretty wit. There is a great, lumbering fellow of prodigious learning, one Samuel Johnson, with whom my Lord Chesterfield has become most friendly. I never saw this Johnson myself, for he is much younger than the men of whom we are speaking. But I hear from London that he is a wonder of learning, and although almost indigent, will not accept aid from his friends, but works manfully for the booksellers. He has described my Lord Chesterfield as a wit among lords and a lord among.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.